Gulotta Studios, I'm David Gulotta, and today I'm going to be working on part of my Mammoth Cave series. Now, as you can see, this is obviously not the natural colors of the cave. This is an emotional impression of this section of the cave. Pillar of Hercules, I believe they're called, and they're very large columns that have formed almost like a gateway between them. And it really struck my mind, and it really struck my feelings very strongly, and I wanted these bold colors in here, these very warm, living colors. So part of the series is in natural colors, part of the series are my emotional impressions of the formations at Mammoth Cave. And you know, it's worthwhile checking out Mammoth Cave National Park. It's a beautiful place. Unbelievable. Well worth it. So today what I want to do is, this was painted in the cave. I brought it back to the studio to finish up. So I've got sketches, little footnotes that tell me where things were. And I've done a lot of studying of caves and cave formations. And this is telling me what types of formations are found within this one formation. You have to see it to believe it. So I have some colors here just to help me accentuate some of these. And as you can see on my palette, I have my paint all set. And yes, I do recommend Old Holland oil paint if you're going to be a professional oil painter. There's nothing better. Although we're going to be doing reviews of oil paint at some point. And this is a medium of my own design. It's a formula I came up with some years ago. Some of my students actually buy the stuff. I call it soft glow. It's a very flexible medium. It breathes very well. So when the canvas absorbs moisture from the air and it releases moisture from the air, of course it expands and contracts just a little bit. That can cause cracks. This helps hold things together and it gives a nice luster to the paint without being like, wow, all that gloss. Who wants that? Yeah. No. Yeah. It's not a photograph. It's a painting. There's a big difference. You put too much gloss into a painting, you lose a lot of details. A lot of the charm of it disappears. So I'm just going to add just a little bit, just like a dab. And in my instructional videos, I go over that and why we only use a little bit. And if you would like to learn more about painting, check out my Patreon page, because that has the opportunity to learn through video lessons and even through private lessons, depending on your level of patronage. And it's not too much. I basically charge the same amount I charge my private students here in the studio. No reason to charge you more just because you're on the internet. That doesn't seem fair. So now I'm just going to mix the medium in. I start with the light colors first. It's a lot easier to deal with a little bit of a light color on your palette knife left over into a darker color than it is getting a dark color accidentally into your light colors. You could really destroy the light color very, very easily. So we go from light to dark, although I do the opposite when I'm painting most of the time. So just give me a second here. This is an active studio. There are going to be times when you hear things in the background. I do have a live-in apprentice. My wife also mostly works from home at her office downstairs. Sometimes they come up and say hello. Sometimes, you know, Amanda right now, she's my apprentice. She's right now in the drawing studio doing some work. And I'm in here in the painting studio doing my thing with you. So this is how we like to do things. I don't want to use a lot of this soft glow. I'm just using a very small amount. If you've used too much, you lose the sense of stone. Most stone is very dry. And in Mammoth Caves, this is particularly true. It's all limestone. So it's going to be a very dry looking structure. But here I want to add those colors too. I want to liven it up with some extra colors. Not that these formations need a lot of livening. They really are amazing. It's an amazing place. Immense. Huge. Wonderful. Can't say enough good things about it. Alright. Now, one of my main shadow colors, the main one I'm using today, is actually an olive green. the opposite of the reds that I have here on the painting. And so that becomes a brown. It darkens the reds. So, got my handy dandy little batch of small brushes, because today a big brush, now you're going to lose all the details that are in here. And you don't really want to do that. Now, I like to start in the back of a painting rather than start right up in the front. Oh yeah, let's start in the front, because at that point what's going to happen is you're going to have to go over and go over and go over, and your edges are going to get messy. You go to the back, you get the back. By the time you get to the front, it's mostly dry and you're able to move forward. Unless you're a speed painter. I'm not a speed painter here, you're going to be able to see. Now, one of the problems that I can see right now is that the yellow that I've chosen is a little on the cool side. It's got a slight greenish cast to it, so I'm just going to take a little bit of Indian yellow, which has a almost like an orangey touch to it, a nice golden color. I'm just going to mix the smallest amount with my nickel titanium yellow here. Oh, there we go. Here we go. I'll show you the difference that makes. You know, right. Whoops. Let's see if I can get the camera going here. Okay, there's the Indian yellow. Here is my nickel titanium yellow. This is it without. And then, as you can see, you just had just a touch, just a little bit. Look at it. It warms it up right away. It gets it nice and warm. It loses a lot of that greenish cast. Right, I'm going to clean off this brush real quick, because you don't want huge globs of paint on the brush, and you really don't want to get paint into the metal, the ferrule, it's called, the metal piece. And that's because the paint can get deep inside the bristles and may come out later on. So, and that's particularly true if you're using things like terpenoid, the turpentine substitutes. Some of them do an okay job, but they don't do quite the job of stripping the paint from the brush like good old turpentine does. And so sometimes you can really get, oh, that's much better. you can really get some paint stuck in the metal. And here I'm going to define the edge. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to give myself enough details to either give me something fun to do later on, or hang myself, so to speak. There we go. And I want some almost like ghostly formations in the back. You know, I want the background to be interesting too. You know, I've seen people do that where the foreground is great. Yeah, I do some finger painting. You know, I have to admit, you know, I can't even say, don't do that, it's not good for the painting. I can't even pretend to say, don't do that, because I do it so much myself. However, I will say I do not rub my eyes. I have to move my glasses, move them from the side, and I don't eat anything here. No thank you. No thank you. I use some very dangerous chemicals with this. That's really what paint is. It's chemical pigments. Ooh, that's kind of interesting looking. I'm going to keep that. Yeah, I like that. This very misty area back here looks very background. You know, looks like it's in the back, but now it's got a clearer edge. I'm just going to warm it up a little bit. I like that warmer tone coming in, because this is a warm painting. So, but I want that chalkiness of the nickel titanium yellow. It's got this chalky quality. It's very charming, and it's very stone-like. Very much like the original limestone that was here. Yeah, that's nice. Kind of warm, but kind of chalky, but kind of distant. This is good. It's a good beginning. All right. Let's get down to the next piece. This is all foreground, so I got to get the keyhole here done. Now the keyhole, I want to define that outer edge. There we go. I'm going to bring it in. Okay? Just like that. I'm going to bring it in. I don't want to change too much back here. And it's okay if it goes over the edge a little bit. I mean, it's just going to get painted over anyway. Yeah, it's not a big deal. There we go. I'm going to get some of this in and just define what might be a path behind the structure, which actually there was. again, really fantastic. If you can get to these caves, and it's in Kentucky, so just look up Mammoth Caves, Kentucky, near Bowling Green, Kentucky. Nice little area, quiet little area, very quiet. But they got some fun, odd things to do, and if you love rocks, if you're a collector of stones, like a rock hound, or my grandfather was a rock hound, so I understand your sickness, I have the same. I love stones, I love anything to do with that, mineralogy, geology. There we go. Alright, and this way I can bring the edges around this keyhole and lay them in and not have to worry about it because the background's already been brightened up. And again, I'm going to add a little extra of this Indian yellow right here just to get some of these warmer tones. It also gives the illusion that there's a reflection of light coming from the main colors of the stones themselves. And you're going to want that. You're going to want that. There we go. Because the light then looks correct. Otherwise, it looks like the background has one kind of light, and your foreground has another kind of light. And you've seen movies like that. Admit it. You've seen that. Looks awful. So you don't want that to happen in your painting either. Now, as you can see, I've got a very close foreground object that's very yellow. I've got some purpley things back here. Right now, I'm working on this. So I want to get these etchings here done. There we go. And that's really all I'm doing. I'm just putting in a further blocking in of the edgings. You can kind of see it almost like the painting comes more into focus. The more I work on it, the more in focus it becomes. That's how I like to think of it. That's probably why it happens that way. I'm sure there are many artists with many different methods where it would look very different with them painting. This is my little method. Unfortunately, I did not learn a lot about painting when I was in college. My focus was on drawing. And that was mainly because I really didn't like the attitudes of the day towards drawing. Drawing was seen as a poor, lesser cousin of painting, rather than the foundation of painting. Most of it is internal to the art world politics. But some of it is also that painting today has gotten away from classic forms. And that's okay. You know, that's great. Everyone should be permitted to paint and draw whatever they like. But unfortunately, a lot of times, the colleges focus only on the one that is popular today. And they don't focus anything on what they consider to be dead. And at the time that I went to college, it was in the dead zone to do anything that had to do with figurative painting, where you actually have a recognizable object in front of you. That having been said, I also was not a particularly patient or good student. I had a real lack of compassion back then. And I also was very frustrated. And I took some of those frustrations out on my professors. And so I never actually did get that degree. I was dismissed for insubordination, for being a lousy student. You know, not taking it seriously, but then I felt that they weren't taking it seriously, so why should I? You know, I thought that was a just question. They disagreed. And that's okay. That's okay. I went on to other things. There was a time when I actually was not painting. I gave up painting for many years and came back to it. Oh, let me think now. About a little over 20 years ago. Before that, I was an incense manufacturer. I had a big mortar and pestle, a bird bath, and a baseball bat. I was making 5-pound batches of handmade incense. That was fun. I enjoyed that. Now here I'm just defining. Just defining things. Just defining. And I went through a lot of life changes and ended up in a place I really enjoy. I really like being where I am. And was encouraged to pursue the arts again by some people who were very close to me, and I'm still grateful to them. They kind of brought my life back. I love painting. I love doing this sort of thing. You know, as I was saying before, and yeah, I'm Mr. Tangent, get used to it. I am constantly tangenting into everything. So I like to gab when I'm painting. So I guess making videos is very helpful for me. Thank you. And we do get some sounds around here because, you know, we got three cats and a rabbit and a snake. And the snake doesn't make much noise, but the cats certainly do. Sometimes the bunny does too if he's knocking things over. He thinks he's a cat. You know, kind of like being raised by wolves. He's raised by cats. So, seems to be doing good. So, and then, you know, there's people here sometimes. Sometimes I have students here at the studio, which is always fun. I like I said in my intros and all that, I like meeting people. I like to share what I do. I'm going to work on this edge here. And no, I'm not working so much back here. I just got some colors in. I want to get them a little bolder. I'm probably going to knock half of them down later on and shadow them. But I want to make sure these edges are ready when I'm working on the main body here. So I'm going to get these edges here done. I'm not going to really worry about what's back here at the moment. As long as this edge is good and I can utilize it without worrying about having to repaint this whole area. And I want that sharp. I want that sharp there. Rather than a smooth transition, because it's an object in front of everything else. So there's going to be that sharper edge. Never wear clothes that you care whether or not it gets paint on. As you can see, I like to wear colorful clothes anyway. I don't think anyone's going to notice if there's a dab of paint. Same thing with like your pants though. I've seen it so many times. People say, oh, I'll be careful. Next thing you know, they have paint all over the pants because they got on their wrist, they leaned on them, you know, they're doing stuff and this stuff don't come out real easy. Especially if you let it dry, forget it. The better the paint, the more washings it goes through. I have some clothes that have been in the wash 100 times and they look like they were just painted. And for me, rather than be annoyed by it, to me I feel really good because it's proof that the paint that I'm using is quite permanent. I like the idea of making permanent messages in a bottle, which is to me what art really is. It's a message that doesn't need a language. And because it can last for so many hundreds of years, it's like a message in a bottle. Now, I don't know what they're going to speak 500 years from now. They probably won't understand a word of this stuff, but they'll understand this. They'll be able to see this and get where I'm coming from. So I like that. I like that. Yeah. All right, here we go. And this area I'm kind of happy with because it's very shadowy here. It's on the back end of a slope. It was very interesting painting in the caves. We were lugging equipment around. We would go about, a quarter of a mile. I mean, the trails down there are miles long. You know, it's not like 100 feet and there's a fancy thing there and then you walk out. A lot of caves are like that. Mammoth Caves is miles, miles and miles and miles of cave. It's over 300 miles of cave. Now, most of that is not open to the public, thank goodness. Preserving that cave is an important thing. But what you do find is the miles of cavern that you can go through have so much, they showcase so much about geology. And they're beautiful, grand, huge, fit houses down there. You can fit an entire city down there. And that grand scale, I want to capture in my series. You know, kind of like doing city streets, you know, doing cave streets, so to speak. So, all right. Now I want to get some of this edging in. I want a brighter color. And at first it's going to look a little odd because it's going to be so bright. There we go. But there's a nice dark color underneath. And that helps. I just want to see how this, you know, before you commit to the rest of the painting, you just want to see what's happening here. Okay. Yeah, that works out. That works out nicely. Now I gotta be careful right up in here because there's not gonna be too much light here. There's so much light coming from here. It's actually gonna darken everything around it. Everything else becomes shadow. So we have to be very careful about that. And not make it too bold with this bright light from behind. Now here it's not a big deal, right where I'm painting now, because this is not a light source. Whereas that looks like it could be a light source. There we go. Yeah, get some little details in. Who knows, I might even drop in some odd bits. I'm known for that. Hidden faces, hidden pictures. I'm a fan of Dali, and I like that sort of thing. I like playing with the mind. There we go. I just want this bit to be up. Okay, I'm gonna put this brush down. It's one of the beauties of oils is that you can actually keep a brush for a particular color in a painting session because it'll take days for this to dry. So your brush is safe for the moment, so it's not gonna matter if you keep some paint on it for a few minutes. And what I wanna do is I wanna grab one of my rounds. This is another brand I highly recommend, Isabi. And yeah, these are rated for acrylics. They're not rated for oils. I find them fantastic with oils because the snap is so hard. You get a nice shape to the tip, and the tip stays that way, even after years of painting. They can last you a very long time if you take care of them. Here we go. I'm going to get some of this dark olive green. And I'm going to come in here. Yeah, there we go. We got some nice shadows going now. I'm going to drop these in. Bring them up. There we go. Yeah, we're going to just bring in that darkness. Because, you know, you need shadow. You know, without shadow, nothing else makes much sense. You know, you lose the shape of things when you lose their shadows. You know, even when you're doing a very bright piece, you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how deep those shadows can be. Even for a painting that looks like it's filled with light, you can have so many deep shadows. I've often surprised myself, you know, trying to do a painting that looks bright and cheerful and light, and the next thing you know, I have to grab some of my darkest colors to bring those lights out so that the light pops. Can't pop if everything's all the same tone. If everything's the same, nothing's gonna stand out. You want things to stand out. You want them to look like they have dimensions. And that's the real trick here. How do you take a two-dimensional object and make it look like it has three dimensions? It's a fun trick. And the nice thing is that you can also use it to express emotions and to make messages and to say whatever you feel you need to say. Now here I'm kind of fancying it up a little bit, as you can see. There we go. These little pieces in here. Yeah, you barely saw this. I can see from the camera you can see this a lot better. We'll take a closer look once this is done. You know, there we go. I'm just gonna put in some shadows. Now some of these will look exaggerated, of course, because there's gonna be more paint on top. There's this big, deep, shadowy area here. It's like this whole thing just emerged from the rock. It's like a like a lobster's back. It was very interesting. And all of this up here almost looks like muscles. Looks like musculature, which is pouring down from the ceiling and becoming these knobby objects down here. It's just beautiful formation. Beautiful. There we go. You see, I have all these shortcuts in here. All these, not shortcuts, sorry, footnotes. The footnotes. They are notes for me, so that even after a period of time, I know what kind of brushstroke I need for a certain area. I know the colors, basically, that I'm going to be working with. And the general shapes of how things were when I was painting and drawing this on the ground. Oh yeah, I was talking about distance and all of that, and, you know, being on the ground. We would go in first thing in the morning. You know, me and my patron, who later married me. There is a story. I'll tell you that one maybe for another video. And we were carrying a rack of paintings, this big wooden thing that we'd cobbled together with rope and bars of wood. And we were carrying, anywhere from 10 to 12 canvases, backpacks, and French easels, the collapsible box easels, all packed up with supplies. We had a drop cloth. We had coasters for the feet of the easel so they wouldn't dig into the ground. Found out later I had done a better job of preserving the cave at Mammoth Cave National Park than National Geographic. That's between you and me. We had a ranger with us who was helping to guide us. There was one in particular who also helped us lug stuff. That was great. She was great. She was very into the project. And then we would stop like every quarter mile, half a mile. And I would see something or find something and I would set up and begin to paint. But I knew I couldn't finish these paintings down there, so everything had to be footnotes, sketches. It was all going to be a sketch on the actual canvas that I was going to use. So this canvas was anywhere from 100 to 300 feet underground. So that's something for it. It certainly held up very nicely. And you can see right here how this is coming into focus. It's beginning to look as if the lens of the mind is bringing it into a sharpness. I like these shapes down here. And this is the kind of thing that I can really play with. These smoky shapes. Again, some of the paintings I'm doing for Mammoth Cave are very realistic. They'll have true colors. I'm not gonna add extra figurines. I'm not gonna, you know, put anything imaginative in those, because those are straight, this is the beauty of the cave. But the ones that are altered in their color to represent my emotional landscape at the time, so it's a landscape within a landscape, you know, mental one with a physical one, that these I can play with and have fun with that. And they were chosen very specifically. Some formations just had a purity to them all on their own that I thought was just absolutely perfect. They were perfect. And then there were others that struck me more emotionally than physically. This was a bit of both. But I decided that, all in all, I wanted this one to be more emotional than realist. Although I think I'm going to be clinging to a lot of the forms here that were already there, because they are, look at this thing, it's astounding. You know, all of this here was all back in here, was like a chamber. And just full of columns, but this one was the giant of them. They also had a formation there called the Devil's Chair or something like that. It was a very odd looking thing. Did kind of look like a chair. They do a lot of that, you know. They name formations after familiar things. They give your mind's eye kind of a point of view of what you're looking at. And also to help make it fun. And I appreciate that. Anything to bring some interest in what's beneath our feet. Most people have no idea. No idea what's beneath their feet. This is what's beneath our feet. Who knows what's down 50 miles, depending on where you are. I'm in Pennsylvania, so yeah, there is 50 miles. So, who knows what formations we have no idea about. Deep down under the earth. Yeah, see, there was all these, like melted wax. Parts of this look like it had melted. And that's not actually true. It's the water leaving behind minerals, limestone. And the water's not there, but the limestone represents what the drips look like. Kind of like when ice forms on a roof. Well, here's ice that leaves itself behind. Through the minerals. And that's why these formations look the way they do. They're based on the same thing, water. Without water, you don't get these formations. Alright, let's see. So that looks like the green is doing a very nice job bringing up our shadows without changing the color into something other than red. Again, that's one of the beauties of oils for me. That's why I love oil painting, because it can do subtle things like that. Look at that. Just even with your finger, you get a nice subtle effect. Titian used to work with his fingers. Apparently he used to drive his apprentices crazy. I like to work with my fingers too sometimes. I use him as an excuse, but it's really just an excuse. I'm a lazy painter. No time to pick up a fresh brush. This is the one thing I think I am impatient about. You have to have patience to be an oil painter. It takes a long time to dry. It's become infamous for that. It takes so long to dry. But I find that the effects you can get working with it because it's not dry more than makes up for the time that you have to wait. There's a lot that you can do. Even tomorrow, some of this will be wet, and it'll be easy to blend. But it won't be so wet that it'll mix instantly. So you can get some very interesting effects with just a little patience. I usually have several paintings going at once. It's something that keeps me sane and not, oh, I haven't finished my painting. This isn't school. You don't have to do one painting at a time. You don't have to finish it up for that report or for that class. These are your paintings. Paint as many as you want, as many as you need. You want to do 8 of them at once? Do 8 of them at once. Have fun. Enjoy that. And that way you're not sitting around waiting for the next layer to dry. I think when you're in a hurry, it means that you're trying to finish them kind of machine-like, one at a time. Finish this one. Finish that one. Finish the next one. Finish the next one. Why? What's the hurry? Why are we in a rush? If it's not going to serve the painting, don't do that. Paintings that are rushed look like it. They lose a lot of their meaning because they lose a lot of their charm. At the same time, you don't want to be so mired in methodology that you don't find any innovation in what you do. But that's really for the professional. That's more of a professional's concern than, someone who's a hobbyist. I like to think of myself as both. It's because I'm not doing things the way I'm supposed to be doing, apparently. There are some very angry people who don't want me doing things this way. That's okay. Sometimes people just need something to be angry with. That's alright. I don't need that. No interest to me. But don't tell me how to paint my stuff. Don't tell me how to display my work. Don't tell me who to talk to or who to sell to. I can do that on my own. I'm a big guy. You know. Yeah. You see, it just came into focus. And that's really what I wanted to do, is to just bring this into focus today. Now, before I use any of these other colors that I've got here, one of the things that I have to do is I have to cover them. This way they'll stay nice and wet for tomorrow. And the next day. You can keep paint going for about 3 days before you have to worry about it oxidizing too much. So, that's real easy. I tend to use plastic wrap and put it over with a paper towel. And that keeps out as much oxygen as possible. And no, the plastic doesn't melt. It doesn't... I've heard more rumors about this kind of stuff than I care to think about. I just want to get this nice dark spot here. I just want to make sure that it's in there. There we go. Yay! You look much better. All right. There. Now it's part of the foreground. Just going to bring that right up in. There we go. Good. Yeah, that's better. I like that better. All right. No, it looks like the footnotes are working, which is always a good thing. And now we have our shadow color in. I'm going to give this a bit of a rest, and I'll go back to it tomorrow to put in some of the lighter colors as well. We tested some of the light colors. They worked out good. We got the shadows in. We got the background light done. And tomorrow we work on mid colors, and if I have the opportunity to, I'll share that with you here. I hope you've enjoyed watching us here at Gulotta Studios, or watching me here at Gulotta Studios, and have a great day, and hey, do some painting, do some drawing, have fun, go out there and have at it. So thank you very much once again. Take care.